So let's take you there with James Brown and Billy Packer.
And welcome to the Coliseum here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, for the second game of our doubleheader as St. John's takes on Arkansas. Both of these teams advance very comfortably. Arkansas with a 30-point victory over Holy Cross. St. John's an 18-point winner over Texas Tech. And good afternoon, everyone. I'm James Brown along with
Billy Packer. And I'll tell you, I'm waiting for a game, JB. This has got to be the worst opening round games in NCAA tournament history. I tell you what, I don't remember such blowouts as we've had so
Billy,
far.
Billy, it has been tough. But now, on paper, this ought to be a much more competitive matchup. And I guess if there's a similarity between these teams, it's got to be defense.
Well, both teams play outstanding defense, and we can see what Arkansas did to Holy Cross. In our first game today, we saw what North Carolina's size did to create havoc. In the case of Arkansas-Holy Cross, with those record number of 31 turnovers, it was speed and quickness.
And those turnovers that Arkansas forced gave them some easy shots on the offensive end.
Well, what is it? You can see that they still had a good perimeter game, and then everything took place down inside. A lot of it was Corliss Williamson in a half-court offense, but a great deal of it created by their defense to set up easy baskets on offensive breaks.
St. John's has been one of the more successful teams getting to the NCAA tournament, but Billy, in recent years, they've struggled going far.
They really have. Had five straight years in which they lost in the opening round of their own tournament. Then you can see right there, not much success in the NCAA tournament since that great run they had in 1985.
Arkansas has a very tenacious defense. Key for St. John's will be the play of its point guard, David Cain.
David Cain had a triple-double the other day against Texas Tech, was truly outstanding in every phase of it, and spends a lot of time down inside of the baseline. Now here, after dipping in, he's able to get the ball back and then penetrates along the baseline. He'll anticipate that there's going to be some weak side help, and what happens? He hits the Foster for an easy layup inside, one of his 11 assists on the game. Here we see the pass. He breaks to the inside. Here comes Foster right down the lane, lays it up.
All right, so those are our thoughts on the game, and why not talk with the folks who will actually be playing in the game? A couple of the principals, the players.
We're going to try and put a lot of pressure on their guards and try to make them hurry up and do things they're not used to doing. Try to make them play at a style that some people may think is rapid and out of control, but we know what we're doing.
Try to keep the tempo at not a slow pace, but at a fair pace. We don't want to really get into a running gun game with them because that's their strength.
As we take a look at the starting lineups, it'll be Middleton, Lyson, Scott, Derrick Brown, and Kane for St. John's. Thurman, Hawkins, Stewart, Beck, and Shepard for Arkansas. The officials for today's contest, the referee Larry Rose, Bobby Dibler, and David Libby. Rose from Franklin, Virginia, Dibler from El Paso, Texas, and Libby from San Diego, California. And Billy, I tell you, if in fact things grew just a bit weary and tough and dragging on in the first game, you need your tennis next on for this one.
Well, what's going to be interesting right there as we see David Cain is, can he control the tempo? You know, when Louis Carnesecca was the head coach at St. John's, it was not a breaking team very often. Brian Mahoney, of course, coached under him many years. The Carnesecca style may be very appropriate for this game, but can you control tempo against this swarming defense? That's going to be a key early on in this one, as was in the first game when we saw Rhode Island had no way to compensate for that height disadvantage they had.
And we'll jump it up again. St. John's, as David Cain indicated, would like to play the control tempo. Arkansas would love the up tempo.
Shawnelle Scott has gotten in a lot of foul trouble. A very limited time in the game against Texas Tech. We'll have to stay out of trouble in this one.
And the tap controlled by St. John's. This is David Cain with the ball.
And it's going to be Corey Beck on him, considered their best heads-up man-to-man defender. Cain beats him right away.
Cain tried to adjust it, still had it partially blocked, but a stay at this end, St. John's. You know, Billy, I was watching David Cain. One of the things that makes him such an excellent guard, he really maintains that vision of the entire floor.
Definitely keeps his head up at all times, and of course, dribble penetration is something that would really help, and anytime you have a team that puts good pressure defense on, they are a team that can stop dribble penetration so that they don't need double teams to take over. Cain's wisely drops all the way back to make the inbounds pass possible.
For those who have not seen Arkansas play, folks, this squad does not make anything easy for the opposition offensively. Hands on every ball. Lyson
played the 1-3-1 zone out of bounds. Lyson, who started things off for St. John's the other day, against Texas Tech is a starter who doesn't stay in the game long, but seems to take their first shot very often.
Nice job that time by
Shepard. Off the mark, rebounded by Shawnelle Scott. The foul is going to be called on Stewart. Dwight Stewart with the push-off, the big fella knocking in at about 270 pounds. And you may ask, how can he keep that weight with a team that likes to go up and down? That may be as low as he can get.
Well, we watched him the other day, and we kind of kidded about him sitting on the bench when they had that game salted away, and his mind looked like it was wandering off to the post-game meal. There's that dribble penetration. Derrick Brown off the rim, and Cain with the rebound. Cain the other evening did a magnificent job, had 12 points, 11 rebounds, and 11 assists. And 11 rebounds is career high. Found himself, and St. John's goes to an old Duke technique, slapping their hands on the floor to get ready to play some D.
Stewart, big fella, showing some ball handling skills.
Shawnelle Scott pushing off there. That would have been a dumb foul against a solid screen. You don't want to pick up a cheap one early. Looks like St. John's is saying, hey, we could play some D too.
Well, you know that's synonymous with the Big East. Most folks call the play in the Big East ugly, but it's very sound defensively. Stewart, the hunter and jumper.
Yeah, that was. And there's Cain, another rebound. And what's this matchup right here? Really critical to see, can Cain's dribbling get by Beck to set up a situation where you have the numbers? He's beat him every time so far.
Yes, indeed. With just enough speed to get by, David Cain getting by Beck and drawing the foul.
And he has put the ball on the floor and beaten Beck on three occasions so far in this game.
Cain kind of interesting in the fact that this year he has only taken 5 3-point shots. Been to the line 150 times, shooting 70%. So you can see what he does. You know, he penetrates and dishes, or penetrates and gets fouled.
And we know what that man has done. Brian Mahoney, Big East Coach of the Year, first year as a head coach after 16 seasons as an assistant to Louis Carnesecca. 7-0 ball game. St. John's on top, just underway here. Second game on the Coliseum.
I think it's Scotty Thurman, and there he is.
Ooh.
Yes, sir.
You were thinking him?
Yep.
He delivered.
I was thinking Thurman there. He hadn't touched the ball offensively. Steps out. And Thurman, the great three-point shooter for Arkansas. That's his 77th on the year, shooting right at 45% from beyond the three-point line.
I tell you, coming into this game, he has more threes on the season than St. John's as a team.
Nice alley-oop to Derrick Brown. David Cain.
Beautiful play.
So far, the quickness of Arkansas has not stymied St. John's.
Nice move. Shepard back out.
Good drive
by Hawkins. Hawkins had a sensational game on Thursday, an NCAA tournament record, 8 steals.
But he was only 2-for-12 from the floor shooting-wise. There's Cain breaking long.
Cain, nice move. What is he playing
for? Oh, boy. And use the left hand on the spin move. And that's one of the things, JB, that you have got to do. Here's Cain delivering, and then we're going to see him receiving. Derrick Brown, good leaper. Excellent lob pass. Derrick cut with a backdoor cut from the weak side, makes it.
Well, Ronnie Rutledge, the assistant coach for St. John's, as Cain misses the free throw, said Arkansas raises 40 minutes of hell defensively, but we think we can raise Cain with David.
Shepard behind the legs.
Stewart with the three. The big fella stepped back for it.
I don't know if that's the kind of shot they want at this stage of the game.
Beck avoided the wall.
This is Thurman.
And Hawkins with the tap in. Can't get it. And Scott, strong rebound.
And there's Middleton breaking. He's got big numbers here.
Leiston. Well, he's doing the same thing he did against Texas Tech. Brian Mahoney starts him because he says, I'm superstitious. Our squad plays well with him as a starter, but he won't be in there more than 8 minutes. And then Luke, who actually plays as a starter with his play, will be in there.
Tough getting anything going on the inside. I don't know if he got by, if that ball was tipped.
In and out from the corner. Scott with the rebound on the Shepherd miss. Big advantage with Scott inside, to not, of course, to the degree of Montrose in the first game, but he's got about 3 inches on Stewart. Good 2 inches anyway, playing above him right now.
We're giving away some weight as he can't control the pass.
So it's a 14-5 quick start for St. John's. And there we can see the tournament appearances. Kentucky at the top, the grade 8 off. Rupp, of course, leading the way. St. John's down there. They went to the Final Four twice. 1952, got beat by Kansas. Frank McGuire coaching that team, returned in 57, coaching North Carolina to beat Kansas. And then, they, of course, they were there in 85 with the Louis Konosecas Club. They got beat by Georgetown. Tough man-to-man being played right now by St. John's, and I think what's going to happen for Arkansas here is you're going to have to figure a way to create some offense off their defense and get the ball down inside, pitching it back out for some threes. The St. John's playing great weak side help defense right now. See the clobber, there it is, inside then back outside for the shot.
Hawkins taking it down, nice pass inside to Stewart, and he scores. Arkansas only 3 of 9. From the field, good defense thus far by the Redmen. 14-7, St. John's lead.
And you can see what that did, JB. When they score, they have an opportunity to set up their press. So far, they haven't been scoring enough to get themselves in that position to really put the press on.
Well, talking with David Cain yesterday, he didn't seem overly concerned at all about the aggressive defense of Arkansas. Looking for Lyson. Pass was actually altered by the defense of Arkansas. It goes to the Razorbacks.
You know, one of the things that David Cain does, he really dribbles the ball low to the floor. He kind of sits down. He's got a little bit of a squat in his run.
And Hawkins,
that's what's available. 2 for 11. 2 for 11 on Thursday, but coming out much better today offensively.
And Arkansas climbing back into it in the early going. 14-25 left in the first half. A battle between the 4 and 5 seed, Arkansas and St. John's, respectively.
And there it is, trying to set up something high to get Shawnelle Scott down low. And the second time today, he's not been able to handle the pass from Cain. And you know what Brian Mahoney's talking about right there? Get a better angle on that pass. See, that pass came from right out top. He wants David Cain to dribble a little bit further down on the sideline to get a better entry angle.
You saw the turnovers, 3 on St. John's as Hawkins takes the shot in and out, rebounded by Scott. The Razorbacks forced 22 turnovers a game.
Nice dribbling there by Cain.
Nice pass to Derek Brown, and even nicer to Middleton, who is fouled. And Middleton, who loves the rough and tumble action on the inside, says he doesn't feel like he's been in a game unless he has bruises on his body.
Well, this is an excellent dribbling move by Cain. He hits one side, then right back to Derek Brown, gives it right back to Middleton, who did a good job keeping his concentration because Hawkins was bearing down on him. Hawkins has to sit, and now the wide body's in for Arkansas as Williamson goes in. Well, I thought that they were going to take out Hawkins, but it was Stewart that he was going in for. Now we're getting wholesale substitutions.
Clint McDaniel comes in for Arkansas, as well as Roger Crawford. And Nolan Richardson will play 10 players. He feels he's got 10 starters on the team, and the way they play defense, certainly you can think that. And also Elmer Martin in for Arkansas. Mitchell Foster's in for St. John's.
It gives Shawnelle Scott a little bit of a rest. He's been banging hard inside. Nice move by both coaches. Scott hasn't had the big offensive production yet, but played very solid on the defensive board.
There's Nolan Richardson, 8th year at Arkansas, 13th year overall as a head coach. And boy, his players love him. Tough love he displays for his guys. They play hard for him. Crawford handling the ball over to McDaniel.
So far, Brown doing a nice job really shielding on Thurman. Thurman trying to get some solid screens from Williamson. That's a nice two-man combination being played on this side for Williamson. A lot of body in there.
Foul call underneath, and you're going to see some physical play whenever you see Lamont Middleton play. He and Corliss Williamson going at it. That called on Milton, his first, and the first team foul for St. John's. 14 fouls for Arkansas.
Well, I'll tell you, I wouldn't want to lean on either one of those two.
And Williamson, as we pointed out the other night, still needs to lose about maybe 10 pounds.
And he looks like he's wanting to post up and get that ball. Let's see if they can get it down to him.
Good steal by Cain. And Cain scores and draws the foul. Is he so smooth?
You know what he did? Smart play there. Rather than try to bust three with big speed, now watch what he does here. He'll kind of slow down a little bit to tie Crawford up and then explode at the end with his body. You know, if you go ahead and you give room for that defender, the defender can come in and block, but he kept his body right on him and then exploded at the last minute. It's a smart player here.
Cain already over 100 steals for his career, and keep in mind, as we mentioned before, did not start the first 3 years at St. John's. This ties the biggest lead of the ballgame, 19-10 Redmen.
Middleton down, gets back on his feet, really showing that aggressive defense.
And McDaniel makes him pay out front with a three.
Clint McDaniel averaging 7 on the season.
Here's that press again, looking to double team.
And a hit.
Some pass.
Oh, good pass, too. Yeah. And they call a push.
Wow, yeah.
As a matter of fact, it was a good pass because it was just about a few inches above the hands of Middleton, who was pushed.
Middleton's kind of smiling on this one. I don't know how much of a push it was. We'll have to see it. Just a touch. Yeah, just a touch. What Middleton did is took his eyes off that pass.
Strong move on the inside by Mitchell Foster.
Foster came up real big. 9 points in the game against Texas Tech. The bench delivered for St. John's, 33 points, 9 rebounds in that game.
Quick turnaround shot by Scotty Thurman. Hard to believe that Thurman is only a freshman, playing with the poise of a senior.
Right, the record holder for freshman scoring at Arkansas. And they've had, of course, some great ones, some All-American players that have played down there. And
Lee Green in for the Redmen, so Brian Mahoney staying right with the substitution as well. I was about to ask if, in fact, Nolan Richardson's substitutions might wear down St. John's, but Brian Mahoney, he'll go 9 or 10 deep on his bench.
Yeah, I think that both teams very comfortable with who they put in. And in the case of St. John's, they put in a lot of guys like Green that are the 6'3", but play bigger than their listed height.
Now let's see how well the bench does handle the press. Cain, Brown, Foster, Charles Menlin, and Lee Green, along with Foster, the 5 for St. John's in red.
Well handled. So far, Arkansas has not been able to force the turnovers that we saw in the Holy Cross game. Here they are, trapping out of their zone.
So smooth. A little too low on the pass, though, to Menlin.
Menlin should have been sitting down ready for that.
Absolutely.
You have to anticipate it that Caton's going to get the ball to you.
But a good defensive play on the part of Menlin to make it
open.
And he gets it. St. John's, Billy, I tell you, when I've seen St. John's push the ball on the court, I think they look extremely effective, but they take good opportunity breaks.
They do. You're exactly correct on that. You know, they don't let you get in a situation where you figure they're never going to break on you.
Williamson had the position on the inside, couldn't handle the ball and loses it. It goes back to St. John's. Johnny's on top, 23-16. Well, Billy Packer, you say we're not quite in deep yet to March Madness. Well, what do you think that is there?
those pink suey hats.
Back to live action here, 23-16. St. John's on top, 11:47 left in the half to play.
Good. Very well handled by St. John's, that press. You know, everybody getting the ball, Cain making himself available.
Foster's got to get rid of it, and making himself smaller, Billy, by keeping the ball low.
Yeah, big guys against this team better get rid of it in a hurry.
Cain. Nice rebound.
Strong rebound by Menlin.
Can't get the drop, but Foster's there.
Throws it.
In and out.
And he wanted it worse than you, Billy.
Boy, you don't see the old-time hook so much anymore. Matter of fact, you very seldom ever see it on the college level. I guess maybe because of the way the defenses are played, Menlin had an easy putback. But watch this. A rolling hook with that big arm up there. Looked like a...
What would you say? That was not quite Kareem. That was more...
That would be a baby hook. That's what Magic would have called it.
Or how about... I'm going to take your way back. How about a Bob Lanier hook? Ooh. That looked like a Bob Lanier hook.
Although not quite the size, so
no.
Maybe a Luke Jackson type of hook.
All right.
Size-wise. Well, we really are dusting off.
Let's
go back there, Billy. Mitchell Foster at the free throw line, looking to add more to the Johnny's lead, and he does.
Well, he's given him solid performance in both games so far.
Mm-hmm.
Valuable coming off that bench.
Once was a starter.
Yep, was a starter. Filled in for Robert Rodan when he got hurt last year and did a good job. There's Foster again.
And doing a nice job on the board.
Oh, and showing off a little bit.
With the one-handed grab.
We'll talk about me being a bench player. And the reason that that was not backcourt, that Cain didn't have full. There's Cain pushing through McDaniel and going to get called. Yeah, there was a case where he got a little bit stubborn.
Mm-hmm.
McDaniel just stayed right in his space and wouldn't allow David Cain to run at all. He got frustrated and just knocked him down.
And you rarely see David Cain.
Yep, and he's saying he's holding
anything.
Yep. You see it right here. Now, what happened is McDaniel said, no, you're not even going to move. We don't see all the play there, but what happened is that he got totally frustrated and just pushed McDaniel out of the way. And no question, the referee all over the call.
Inside to Williamson. And Corliss Williamson in and out. He's fouled by Shawnelle Scott. That'll be the first personal on Shawnelle Scott. Fourth team foul for St. John's.
Well, Williamson really explodes when he gets the ball down low. Was 8 for 12 with 19 points against Holy Cross. They could not handle him at all in the low post. Not many people can.
No doubt about that. The best sixth man in the Southeastern Conference.
All-conference second team despite missing 16 games this year.
Isn't that remarkable?
Yeah.
And here's Robert Shepherd into the game for the Razorbacks.
And we'll talk about that foul before. Now watch. There's Cain. You see, he cannot run through a man. He just got frustrated there. When a guy gets in your face, you back off and go around him. You have no right to run through him.
Medlin with the rebound. Now, Billy, I mentioned the word fatigue in talking about St. John's earlier. They can go 9-10 deep, but certainly the word fatigue might apply late in the game to David Cain. We'll see. He hasn't had a break yet. Scott blocked and is fouled by Martin.
Well, one of the things that happened the other day is Maurice Brown came off the bench and played some very valuable minutes when Cain had to sit down. There we see the foul coming up by Martin. Without question, Scott had good position in the low post.
Middleton back in for Midland. Middleton got a breather. So we'll find out when Cain gets a breather.
Scott, second team all Big East this year, had some big games. The biggest, of course, was that 20 points, 19 rebounds against Seton Hall. And we talked about the Luther Wrights and the Jerry Walkers earlier on. When you have those kind of productions against a team that's going to battle you down on the low post like Seton Hall will, that is a big night.
That is physical play as well. We saw Martin take a seat on the bench. McDaniel back in as Scott misses the first.
They'll only shooting 52% from the line this year. He's been there over 100 times, so not good production. And has a good-looking stroke.
That he does. We saw the major also by Scott, communications arts major. He'd like to move into this line of work. 26-17. St. John's on top. 10-19 left in the first half.
Where was he in the first game when we needed him?
Oh, my goodness.
He wants to broadcast. Let him broadcast a game like that one.
He'd gladly join us, I'm
sure.
Hawkins penetrating. Nice move by Hawkins. Talk about slicing the middle.
And again, here's the press. What St. John's has done it. There's the first time they turned it over today.
Shepherd fouled on Scott. And this will be the second personal on Shawnelle Scott. 15 foul on St. John's, and Scott looking to the bench.
He's not going to get any help. He's not going to get any help over there except if they put Foster in the game. And what he's trying to do is a little hand combat against Williamson. And there was that blowout
we were here for
that we had in the first game. Here's Foster. Well, he looked for help, and he got it. Here comes Foster.
Actually, the kind of help that Scott was looking for was to have Brian Mahoney tell him what to do. But, hey, let me sit you down and talk to you.
Then wanted to pick up, of course, that third foul right here in the start of the ball game.
Beck draws the foul, taking it right to the hoop. Fearless Arkansas players going right to the hoop, Billy.
They really are. And they love to post up down inside. Corey Beck, even though listed as a guard, does not mind playing that forward position. Odd combination here. He can go out and play tough man-to-man defense as a guard, and then he can go down and post up against you on the other end of the floor.
Carl Beckett back in to the lineup for St. John's.
Now, do we have any, is this a possibility of some blood showing?
He went strong to the hoop, didn't notice anything, but let's see, we can't see anything visibly there.
I don't know, there may, I think there is going to be some blood showing.
Billy, you know, it has to be that,
yep.
There's no question.
Yep. Now,
and again, the rule on this?
Right, the rule is, of course, that he must have it attended to, the blood must be stopped. And anybody, of course, could come in off the bench and shoot the free throw. And who would you like to have come in there but the leading freshman scorer in the history of Arkansas? But Scotty Thurman will take the shot.
82% free throw shooter, and that's exactly what's happening with the trainer tending to the blood situation there with the gloves.
Yep. Officials, pretty sharp eyes to catch that one down around the ankles, huh? Mm-hmm. Thurman hits 1-2. You can see how St. John's is setting up against this press. So 1-4, nobody guarding the man, taking the ball out of bounds. So far, St. John's has gone ahead and gotten the ball in bounds every time but one.
And Derrick Brown relieved Cain of the ball handling duties that time. Cain getting by and is hammered by Shepard. Cain has such a unique knack for getting by people without what seems to be an awful lot of blazing speed, Billy.
Well, you know what he does? Watch him right here. He keeps his body to the man and then explodes on by rather than giving the man any opportunity to have space to reach in for the steal. And the other thing that I really liked about David Cain there is how smart he was to realize that McDaniel was setting him up for one of those slaps from behind, steal from behind. He just changed the dribble as soon as he got by.
St. John's in the 1-1 because Arkansas with 9 team fouls. That last foul was called on Robert Shepard, his first. And Cain makes them pay.
And Cain doesn't show any signs, JB, of being wore down at all.
At all, not thus far.
And that's because I think his teammates have done a good job helping him beat the press. He hasn't had to dribble through it.
Cain has 8, averages 11.
Foster and Williamson down inside.
Off the mark, McDaniel. Foster with the rebound. Here comes Cain.
Goes right on by Thurman.
Not a tough pass that time, but Beckett gets the loose ball, goes up and is fouled, and it'll be called on Cornus Williamson, who will pick up his second personal foul. 10th team foul for Arkansas, so double bonus this point forward for St. John's.
And JB, we talked about this unusual bench type that St. John's have. Beckett is another one. 6'3 to 6'5 in height. Like to mix it up around the boards. Midland the same way. Green the same way. So they're matching up pretty well with Arkansas, with the type of athletes that Arkansas normally beats you with.
You're right. You would think that body type would be more a perimeter type player, but they love it underneath.
Exactly. They don't mind going in there. They run good on the break. A lot of strength.
Biggest lead of the ball game for St. John's, 10 with 9:01 left in the first half of play.
Playing behind Williamson, and he's going to want to shoot that turnaround jumper of his, and there it is.
Almost an up and down situation, but a pushing foul is called, and I believe it's going to be on Lamont Middleton. And if that's the case, Middleton picking up his second foul.
You see, they're playing behind Williamson, and one of the reasons that they're forced to do this is he's so quick that he pins you. I mean, he has the nice combination of strength and quickness, and if you try to play around on the side, he'll just hold you there with that power, get the proper angle, and beat you to the basket. So St. John's is off the play right behind him, hoping that with their size, he can combat that turnaround jumper. Had a down period during the SEC tournament where he didn't score in double figures in either game, but bounced back, obviously, with a very solid ball game against Holy Cross, 8-for-12.
And back in the ball game for Arkansas is Beck. The open wound taken care of. McDaniel on the bench. The rebound by St. John's. Beckett
waits for Cain to come back and take it.
Cain, Beckett, Derrick Brown, Lamont Middleton, and Mitchell Foster, the 5 for St. John's in red.
Now Shepard on Cain, the number one stealer in the SEC. Beckett, a tough leaner.
Rebate. Ahead to Thurman. Cain with him. What a spin.
Oh, yeah, what
almost
a...
in. Beck with the rebound and goes up in traffic. Can't get the roll.
Well, I oh,
the has a steal by Thurman.
And finally, I tell you, Thurman got fouled, I think, on both plays. Nothing called. Sensational.
additional plays by Scotty Thurman.
30-23. St. John's on top. 8:05 left in the half. The number four seed, Arkansas, taking on the fifth seed, St. John's.
Foster stepping way out. Derrick Brown called for traveling. Good defense by Thurman on that play. Now here's where Thurman takes the ball away from Foster and then goes right back up inside and pulled that ball back over his head for the shot. Great play.
Second ever meeting between St. John's and Arkansas. The first was back in the 85 NCAA second round play. St. John's victorious. Right now the score 30-23. St. John's on top with 7:50 left in the half.
And you know what's interesting about that game? Eddie Sutton's last game as a coach at Arkansas before he moved on to the University of Kentucky. Of course, now leading his club at Oklahoma State, back at his alma mater, and they're still alive in this tournament.
The bottom line with Eddie Sutton is he can coach.
Yep.
Called on the inside, and I believe it's on David Cain, and if that's the case, it'll be only the first.
No, he had Cain. He had that other one, remember, pushing offensively, so that pick up they call off.
Yep, well, you're right.
A little offensive when he got frustrated by McDaniel's defensive play a little while ago.
Yes, indeed, you're right. And that makes the eighth team foul for St. John's.
That could be very important. 7:34 to go. Cain's going to have to be very careful on defense, but even more so when he penetrates that offense not to pick up a charge.
Shepard on the line, 74%. Hadn't been there often.
Primarily a defender. He keeps everybody honest.
Believe it or not, Shepard was out of the lineup, the starting lineup, for 7 games this season. That because he had a problem with being foul prone, but he is back and playing awfully strong for Nolan Richardson.
And there you see that 1-3-1 trying to trap out of it. Thurman out on top, pretty big target to try to throw over. See if Cain tries to split this defense with the dribble. He's looking. 1-3-1 trap. Cain the split.
Dribble penetration. Nice
there it
pass
is
to Middleton.
Now wait a second. Is that a charge? That's his third. What did I say,
my
JB?
Goodness gracious, Billy.
He's going to have to sit down. Now we're going to see
Maurice Brown, you would think.
Right. I just had the sense that Cain was going to get called for a charge. He tried the dribble penetration. This is a tough blow for St. John's. Great defensive move by Arkansas.
So Maurice Brown comes in to replace David Cain, who picks up his third and has to take a seat. That at the 7:03 mark of the first half, and the Redmen on top 30-24. As Maurice Brown comes in, he did have 3 minutes of action the other night against Texas Tech, where he dropped in 5 points. 7:03 left in the first half of play. St. John's, the number five seed, on top of the fourth seed, Arkansas, by the score of 30-24. James Brown, along with Billy Packer and David Cain, has to take a seat on the bench. The starting point guard for St. John's with 3 personal. And Maurice Brown, the freshman, comes in to replace David Cain. There he is, first team All Big East.
JB, to give you an example, the difference of experience, you've got David Cain averaging 36 minutes a game in playing time, Maurice Brown 4 minutes a game. So now the load is going to be very heavy on Brown. And somebody held him.
Called. And you know, that's exactly what David Cain was complaining about earlier, but you said out of frustration, Cain pushed off and picked up that first foul that way.
Right.
John's blistering from the floor, also at the free throw line a lot more frequently than Arkansas. The rebounds in favor of St. John's. Cain has to sit down, although he's got 11 points to his credit.
And you can see shooting 62% to St. John. Arkansas used to holding opponents down below 45%.
Maurice Brown, a lightning quick 5'9 guard who was a New York City Public School Player of the Year, and recognizes that he would not see much time this year because of Cain,
the apparent floor leader of the future. Right now, he's got to do it today.
Well, one of the things he has going for him, and that is he's built very low to the floor, and that'll help with some dribble penetration.
And Hawkins shooting very far out on the floor for a three. Arkansas within two.
Oh, there's the steal by McDaniel.
Foster, strong rebound, and keeps it high this time.
Nice pivoting
most
by Foster.
Time.
Very nice pivoting by Foster to get out of trouble.
Fred Lyson in as well for St. John's. This is Derek Brown. In and out. Rebounded by Shepard. This is what the Razorbacks love to do.
But McDaniel really sat down to steal that ball on the dribble.
And St. John's, Billy, also did a nice job of transitioning from offense to defense.
Five seconds, big call. Nobody broke to the basket.
Good defense by Brown. As we take a look at the bracket here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina moves to the Sweet 16. The victory, 45 points worth over Rhode Island. Next up for the Sweet 16 will be the victor here between St. John's and Arkansas.
Of course, in that first game, it just was too much of everything by North Carolina, and primarily size. Right over the top of Rhode Island, frustrated them early and often.
Middleton, Minland, Maurice Brown, Lyson, and Derek Brown, the five for St. John's in red.
Maurice Brown was hit in the eye, and he really doesn't see real well right now. You notice how different the pace of the game is with Brown in there. You know, Cain was able to get all other fellas kind of controlled. Now there's a little bit of frenzied activity by St. John's. Not what they want against this Arkansas club.
Somewhat the same kind of skills possessed by both players, but a total difference in terms of experience.
Sure.
As you mentioned. And that foul is called on Stewart. Second personal on Dwight Stewart. Midland at the free throw line.
Here's what we're talking about, the type of sub that St. John's has. 6'5", crash the boards, good strength, total overall game.
The only player in St. John's history, Billy, to major in pharmacy. And he bangs home the second shot. 32-29, St. John's 5:39. Left and a half to play.
Midland on Stewart down inside, giving up about 3 inches.
And Brown picks up the foul, reaching in on the shot by Shepard. Well, Ernie Banks, as you recall at the top of the day, said, let's play four. Game three of the sequence coming up. Illinois, Vanderbilt, BYU, Kansas, Western Kentucky. Ralph Willard will be taking on Seton Hall, a team that is seriously on a roll for Hall.
You know, Shepard's going to pick up two shots on this one, and it really was the kind of case where Brown probably should have let him take that shot. You know, he was off balance. It would have been a flying shot going across the lane. Tough to make.
Billy, I was trying to figure out why the game maybe hasn't been more of an up-tempo one as we thought it might be, and certainly we know St. John's wants to control the tempo, but 22 fouls in the game will certainly create this kind of tempo as well, but a tight game.
And here's that 1-3-1 with Thurman out front. Now remember, Thurman has got a lot of inches, and he's tough to throw the ball over. So you don't want to pick up that dribble there.
Finland gets his own rebound, hammered from behind. Thurman actually got him as well, but it looks like David Libby got Stewart with the personal foul.
You see Midland, 6'5", Middleton, who they list taller, but is just about 6'5". Not a lot of size in there for St. John's, but they're getting it done. Resting Foster and Shawnelle Scott, who's sitting on the far end of the bench, looking like he's lost his best friend.
And taking a seat for Arkansas is Stewart with three, as Corliss Williamson comes back in to replace Dwight Stewart. Well, I mentioned Midland being a pharmacy major takes his studies quite seriously because he said his parents would have it no other way.
Yeah, I like the story about people asking him, of course, coming from across the ocean, saying, well, how do you travel over there? A covered wagon? Or, you know, he said, no, usually in a Benz.
In a Mercedes Benz, his father, a former diplomat.
Shepard from downtown looking to shoot his shot early. There's Thurman. Soft gliding shot of his.
And a good aggressive hustle on the part of Shepard, but he can't get the drop.
Well, the problem is St. John's has no size in there, and Arkansas is just playing volleyball with him.
Thurman, fourth of that range. Middleton pushes off, doesn't get called. He's got the rebound.
Ahead. What did we see in the first game when Rhode Island sent five men to the boards? There's Scott sitting there, and he's got to watch this one. But what happened in the first game? Rhode Island sent five men to the board and had nobody back. That's what happened to Arkansas there.
And Williamson is fouled by Midland. Williamson using that size to his advantage. And bulk.
Well, everybody playing behind him. And there is the case of Midland did a good job, but he came down on the hand, and Williamson just so strong. Watch this, he powers right through that shot.
And the first appearance this afternoon by Warren Lynn, the senior guard out of Tulsa, Oklahoma, replacing Scotty Thurman.
Lynn, not a bad three-point shooter. He's made 19 on the year, and he exploded to shoot some threes when he came into the game the other day.
Actually considered the best pure shooter on this Arkansas team, just not very quick.
Now he's going to play out on the top of the 1-3-1, makes it even bigger. So Brown's got to be careful not to pick up his dribble here, because it'll be tough to throw over the point.
Lyson with the ball. Derrick Brown now with the ball. Maurice Brown, Lamont Middleton, and Charles Midland, the five with the small lineup for St. John's out there. And Maurice Brown having his difficulties. Midland, power move on the inside.
Beautiful. You know what? Brown, by screwing up his dribble, actually created the space that was necessary to make that play work.
He'll tell you it was planned.
Yeah. Lucky he didn't get a double dribble call.
Beck, trying the spin move, is fouled by Derrick Brown. And Derrick Brown will pick up his second personal foul.
Beck showing that he loves to go down in that low post. You can see the tape on his leg there that was caused by the slight cut.
You're right, Billy, that was an awfully good piece of eyesight by the officials to see that.
Corey Beck came in from junior college after just 1 year. We talked to the trainer earlier during practices, and they talked about his asthma condition, that sometimes he's got to go ahead and, you know, get a little bit of special treatment there, but it hasn't affected him so far in this tournament.
Mm-hmm. He was teasingly saying one thing that he thought might help that asthma condition was his taking charges. He's taking the most charges on this team, 31, thinking maybe that might knock it loose, but
I have the chest. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 38-35, St. John's on top. No 340 left in the ball game. Make that the first half of this ball game between St. John's and Arkansas.
Nolan Richardson stays in the 1-3-1 trap.
Good hand, yep, by Shepard.
Oh, how about that power? Midland created an opportunity for his team to retain possession just by using his strength.
And it will stay on this end of the floor. St. John's ball when we come back. 3:30 left in the first half of play here, and at the half, you'll see the Prudential Securities at the half with Jim Nance, Bill Raftery, and Mike Francesa coming your way. And those folks will give you a taste of the game with the score you see there. Florida State on top of Tulane.
Good job by Millen to break to the basket.
A little too hard on the shot.
He had no angle for the shot once he got there. Unless he would have put it up left-handed, and that might not be in his arsenal.
That classic case of confusion where you don't know whether to go off the glass or straight ahead.
Straight ahead is what Warren Lynn did. And we talked about him being a real three-point threat. That one was from downtown. And Brown goes
to travel. Now that's a travel when you go down with it and lose your footing.
Now, when Cain sat down, St. John's was ahead 30-24. They find themselves in a position now to go behind, so you can see how important that foul was on Brown.
A tie ball game with 3-10 left in the first half, Billy.
Mm-hmm. And still, St. John's stays small. Gives Williamson a chance down here if they can get the ball to him on Midland, and they've got him.
And Williamson is fouled.
St. John's is too small to guard him from behind with Midland. Now, they got by with it when they had Foster and Shawnelle Scott in the game,
but they can't guard him with a 6'5" man from behind.
And there's Shawnelle Scott still on the bench. The foul that time on Charles Mendlin, his second, and Williamson looking to give Arkansas its first lead of the ball game.
Remember, Shawnelle Scott had 8 points in only 8 minutes in the first half against Texas Tech. So he has spent a great deal of time in Winston-Salem here observing as opposed to playing games.
Mahoney, Brian Mahoney, reacting to your point about a small St. John's squad on the floor, sends in Mitchell Foster.
So this is all that he could do. I mean, he had to recognize that they were now starting to pound inside and he was just too small to play with them.
Foster at 6'9", and Williamson gets the second one. He'll take it as Arkansas takes its first lead of the ball game. Williamson sits down, Elmer Martin in for Arkansas.
I'll tell you another thing that's really hurt St. John's. They haven't figured out a way to score against the 1-3-1 trap.
Maurice Brown loses it off of his own leg. Back to Arkansas.
And if you're St. John's, what you're trying to say right now, I've scored him 15-8 since Cain left. You're having to say, please, clock, get moving quickly so we can get in at halftime with Cain available to come back in the game. Now, Cain's asking to go back in the game now himself, but you couldn't afford to do that.
Not at all. Not a good move. Would not be. Foster can't hold it. Middleton does. And a foul is called on Elmer Martin of Arkansas.
Not a smart play because, as we know, both teams have shot a lot of fouls. St. John's now goes the line to shoot two.
You see the Florida State Tulane score 42-30, and we will give you a taste of that game at halftime, specifically Nance Raftery and Francesa on the credentials. Securities at the half as Thurman comes back in for Arkansas. The middle personal on Martin.
You like to break records, but Middleton earlier this year had one that he did not want to break, and that is one where he missed 16 of 17 free throws against Providence.
That's ugly. You're right.
Yeah, it really is.
Beckett in for Lyson for St. John's.
A little bit more quickness. It's going to be up to Foster and Middleton now, though, to hold the ground on the inside. Kind of surprised Nolan Richardson took Williamson out. You know, he was presenting a lot of problems down low offensively for St. John's to handle.
I guess he didn't want Williamson to pick up his third personal.
Very possible.
St. John's retakes the lead. Beck misses. This is Lynn. Around to Martin.
Lynn wanting to set up for his three out here. Brown recognizing now that he's got that kind of range. Thurman is a patient scorer.
Yes, he is. And only, again, a freshman.
Yep.
So patient. Beckett, strong rebound. And he's nearly taken away by Beck. But I think Beck will be called for the foul.
I tell you, these fouls are really helping St. John's because they were having a hard time scoring against that 1-3-1 trap. Now they're able to pick up some points with the clock not moving by getting fouled. Boy, Arkansas trying to challenge everything. Now, one of the things that should be available for a rebounder is to fire the ball out quickly, realizing you're being pressed. The minute you get a rebound, fire it out quickly and get a fast break started because Arkansas, at best, can only have two guys back.
You're right, and you don't have to be tall to do that. That's
exactly
just the mindset.
Just get it out there quick, hit the first free man, and be in a situation where you've got a 3-on-2 break going.
Well, Nolan Richardson will certainly be able to count on some size next year and an outstanding recruiting year.
St. John's packs things back down inside. Yeah, but Martin, not the offensive threat that was Williamson, so they're not as concerned about him touching in the low post. See, he's not looking for his shot.
Thurman will look for his. In and out. Foster, too strong, loses it off his leg.
Well, too bad that
Beck stepped on the outline.
Well, it's too bad Beck went after that ball because it actually would have been off Foster. Arkansas, with a little delay here, gets a chance to pick up full court again.
Carolina, 45-point victory over Rhode Island, largest in the tournament thus far. Tulane, Florida State, as we mentioned, you'll see some of that game in just a bit.
Middleton hiding down behind Beck, hoping that Beck loses sight of him so he can sneak in there for an easy score. There he is, Foster.
Fouled, but no call. Gets his own ball back. And Beckett was pushed, yep. And the foul is called. Elmer Martin will pick up the personal foul, and that will be number four, according to the numbers we have here.
It is his fourth, but you know, in the case of Nolan Richardson, you could go ahead and waste that. And maybe that's what he was trying to do, go ahead and waste some fouls. Shanil Scott sitting down on the bench. Foster really doing a big job for St. John's while he's been in there.
Ray Biggers comes in for Arkansas at 6'8". As Martin takes a seat.
You can see that out, and boy, how important has this been, particularly with Cain down. St. John's able to pick up their points against this tough 1-3-1 with foul shooting. And St. John's, as a team this year, shooting 66%. They've been to the foul line a lot, 762 times. There's another hook by Foster.
He likes that hook.
Oh, beautiful play.
45-39, St. John's gets a bit more of a cushion with 45 seconds to play in the half.
And he's fired up on defense. Now, he doesn't want to pick up a cheap foul, ran right through Beck's screen, knocked Beck to the floor.
8 seconds difference between the game clock and the shot clock. Thurman, in and out.
That was Beck to keep it alive, and there's Foster again.
Seven rebounds on the afternoon for Foster, doing a good job.
Yep, and there was another opportunity, what I was talking about. When you get the rebound, go long quickly, take a chance. Because what Arkansas is doing is sending four men to the boards.
Valuable playing time in a pressure situation for Maurice Brown, the freshman guard in for St. John's. David Cain again on the bench. In foul trouble, Brown makes a drop. Huge shot.
It's a two-point basket.
They call it a two.
No time remaining. That's it. And what a job by the young man who had to fill in. A shaky start he had, but came back strong to save the Johnnies.
Filling in for David Cain, who has three personals. That's the end of the first half with the score. St. John's 47, Arkansas 39. CBS Sports exclusive coverage of the NCAA basketball championship will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports exclusive coverage of the second round of the NCAA basketball championship is sponsored by the people of Nike, who encourage you to just do it. Energizer brand batteries, nothing outlasts the Energizer. They keep going and going and going. And by ITT, when it comes to building business at ITT, we're adding more than just our names. CBS Sports presents Prudential Securities at the Hash. Sponsored by Prudential Securities. The most important thing we earn is your trust.
This is Prudential Securities at the Half. He's Bill Raftery. Mike Francesa, St. John's graduate. I'm Jim Nance. And hey, Mike, your Johnnies survived David Cain's absence.
He's the heart and soul of the team. Went to the bench with a 6-point lead, 3 fouls, 7 minutes left. They not only withstood it, they upped the lead by a bucket.
Well, Mike Francesa, they bring the basketball up slowly, much like you. Just make the timeline, and then they're patient. I think that's the key here. Make Arkansas work. They've had a few turnovers in the open floor, but this is a very deep St. John's team.
All right, the winner of that game gets North Carolina at the Meadowlands on Thursday. Florida State trying to break it open against Tulane. Let's check in on that game now with Sean McDonough and Derek Dickey.
Two free throws by Matt Green of Tulane cut Florida State's lead to 15 points, 49-34 with 15:20 left here in Orlando. This is second round action in the Southeast region. Charlie Moore the long, Rodney Dobard the dunk. That's the second time they've worked that play to perfection.
That play is indicative of what Florida State's doing. They've played great defense the first half, ignited it with some steals on the defensive end. Tulane has to get back into this game. They played good defense early, not able to get in it because they've given the ball away for easy layups.
Like that one. Not quite as easy as some, but 15 points for Sam Cassell. This is the largest lead for the Seminoles, 19 points, built by a 22-5 run that extends back to the first half.
Another outstanding pass by Charlie Ward to Rodney Dobart, who missed part of the first half because of an injured toe. Showed no signs of the injury on that play.
Lebeldro Simmons returns to the Tulane lineup for Matt Green. Williams and Simmons the backcourt now. Nichols, Reed, and Perry up front for the Green Wave. Nichols lost it, as did Simmons. Florida State has it back. Tulane this half for Coach Clark is 1-for-10 from the field. There's some concern in New Orleans, Derek, that this could be Perry Clark's last game as Tulane coach. Rumors continue to swirl that Bobby Crimmins will go to South Carolina. Perry Clark, his former assistant at Georgia Tech, might return to Georgia Tech as the head coach. Three-pointer for Sam Cassell. He's up to 18, matching his season average.
Well, in talking with Perry Clark, he talked about rebuilding, and we're going to talk some more after that.
So Florida State breaks it open. This game was 31-29 just before the half, and then they went on 8 unanswered right before the half. Similar spot, really, for Tulane as a year ago. They beat St. John's a year ago in the first round, and remember what Oklahoma State did round two in this spot?
Oklahoma State beat them pretty handily, and Tulane is a team that has to get some points off the turnovers. They have to score with their defense. Florida State, with the three guards, you can handle the ball too well.
Bobby Bowden's been looking for a favorable toe for Florida State. Unfortunately, the basketball team is Rodney Jammin.
Rodney Dobart. All right, Raph. That's good. We'll get back to another look at that game when we continue on the road in a moment. That's good. All right, St. John's leads by 8 at halftime of the game you're watching. Let's get back out, though, to Florida State and Tulane. They resume play. Back to Sean McDonough with Derek Dickey.
Nearly 6 minutes into the second half, Florida State enjoys its largest lead, 22 points cut to 21 by the free throw. Florida State has outscored Tulane 17-6 here in the second half. Florida State has hit its last 6 from the field, while Tulane has 1 for its last 10.
Florida State has built this lead by playing great defense, playing the passing lanes, forcing turnovers, and hitting open shots.
Bob Sura missed the rim, but Edwards was there to follow, and he has 20. They go along with 8 rebounds.
Edwards with the basket.
Akiba Perry. Batted it to Cassell. Good hands by Williams as he stripped Dobart. It's 3-on-1 for the Green Wave. Nice passing. Perry and Green, and it's Green with the basket. 10 points for Green. It gets the lead under 20.
Green Wave is going to have to have a lot more of that to get back in this basketball game.
Cassell. Acrobatic catch of the pass from Ward. Ward still has not attempted a shot today. Cassell gives it to Ward. Dobart, the finish. Off the fancy feed from the quarterback, Charlie Ward.
Florida State's doing an exceptional job with passing, stealing the basketball.
Williams lays it in. Points for Pointer Williams, the sophomore from
You never know what to expect when it comes to Florida State, Mike Francesa. You remember the game against North Carolina this year, but they're well on their way now to the Sweet 16. You also always expect in the Sweet 16, North Carolina. 13 straight years now, the Tar Heels will make it to that round as they blew out Rhode Island today by 45, the largest second-round victory in the tournament since they went to a field of 64 teams. And Derek Phelps, who was a question mark coming into the tournament, 7-of-7 from the field, 15 points. Now, St. John's leads by 8 over Arkansas. They're about to start the second half. Mike, what about the second half here?
I think the key is Arkansas hasn't had that big run that you expect them to have a couple of times during the game. St. John's has got to limit those couple of surges that you know they're going to get in the second half.
Another wide body. Corliss Williamson. Get him in the game. 5 points when he catches it, he can punish the opponent.
All right, we'll look for that in the second half, guys, and we'll get you back out there to James Brown and Billy Packer when we continue after this message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports presents Prudential Securities at the half. Sponsored by Prudential Securities. The most important thing we earn is your trust. CBS Sports' exclusive coverage of the second round of the NCAA Basketball Championship is sponsored by Pontiac and your nearby Pontiac dealers. We are driving excitement. Your Allstate agent for home, auto, life, and business insurance. You're in good hands with Allstate. And by Enterprise Rent-A-Car, the special delivery company.
Back inside the Joel Coliseum in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. The fifth seed, St. John's, leading the fourth seed, Arkansas, 47-39. James Brown along with Billy Packer. And Billy, as we take a look at the field goal percentage, St. John's really getting some nice shots on the inside and doing a good job defensively against Arkansas.
They really did. And, JB, most of that 57% was early on in the first half. They made it up in the latter part of the first half when Arkansas played that effective 1-3-1 zone by going to the foul line a lot. And look at those second chance points. Leading scorer is David Cain. We all know what a serious problem he created by going down with the three fouls. He'll be back here, of course, to start the second half, and has got to stay out of foul trouble. The St. John's going to control this game.
We heard Mike Francesa in the studio mention he was awaiting the surge that you would expect from Arkansas here in the second half, and Bill Raftery saying we need to see more. Corliss Williamson, of course, I think Nolan Richardson was trying to keep Williamson out of foul trouble. I know you've got to see him a lot more here in the second half.
Well, he's going to start in the second half, and of course, we know that Williamson has had some big games, 26 points against Tennessee, 22 against Kentucky. He is capable of exploding on the inside.
Starting the second half of action here at the Coliseum in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. St. John's on top of Arkansas, 47. And with that shot by Scotty Thurman, Arkansas cuts the lead to 5, 47-42. James Brown along with Billy Packer. David Cain handling the ball now. Went to the bench with three personal fouls in the first half. And Billy, he was sensational when he was in there.
And here you see Arkansas getting out of the 1-3-1 and going to a basic 2-3 zone. Matching up inside. Scott gets the roll. He really needed a break to get himself back on fire.
Shawnelle Scott sat quite a while. He had two personal fouls. Brian Mahoney did not want him to pick up a third. St. John's has done a nice job of controlling the tempo and handling the defensive pressure of Arkansas. This is Thurman from way downtown, rebounded by Shepard.
Nice play. Puts it back up with the left hand. Can't get it to fall. And there's Hawkins.
Shepard has it blocked.
Thurman again.
Wow.
And gets
unbelievable.
Out. And is this Shawnelle Scott down? He's been down for a long time. A lot of battle and activity inside, and Scott has had his problems, first of all with foul trouble, and now what looks like an injury.
And the quickness of the guys from Arkansas on the boards while Shawnelle was down. Let's see if we can find out what happened to Scott.
Well, he was in there with Corliss Williamson banging on the inside. We see him right down on the inside. Now let's follow the activity and see what happens here. Banging. Got an elbow right in the back of the head.
Yeah, Williamson,
he says he's
got him
all
with
right
a good
now.
Shot. Williamson got him with a good shot.
Well, he better get himself ready and get right back into the basketball game. Obviously, St. John's didn't want to use a timeout there, so they take him out. You see how quickly Brian gets him back in. But Scotty Thurman was sensational on the boards that last sequence.
And Billy, you and I have underscored this point throughout, but arguably the best freshman in Arkansas history, and that's saying something when you consider the names that have been through Arkansas.
He's had two 34-point games this year. You pointed out at the top that Thurman with his threes almost equaling St. John's as a team with threes. One separated the two coming into the game. There's that 2-3 zone matching up.
Foster. And Lawrence Middleton is going to have to make that. Lamont Middleton have to be careful. He's got three personal fouls, avoiding the foul there with Williamson on the rebound. Hawkins inside to Beck. Beck loves the traffic inside. Nice pass to Shepard, who can't get the shot.
And there's Foster, who has had a great game for St. John so far.
That he has, Billy, 8 rebounds specifically.
You know what his talent at St. John's has taken away? The quickness of Arkansas by the way they've controlled the tempo with his game. They just haven't let him get started. Lyson wanting to shoot quickly. There's Middleton. Put it back. Lyson is amazing how he can get off the shots at the start of the first half and the start of the second half.
Which is why he starts. And only for a few minutes of that, Beck double pumps and draws the foul. Billy, I'm still amazed. You made the point early on about Beck loving the inside traffic spots. At only 6'2", he loves to play in the land of the Giants.
Yep, he's 6'2", very powerful, has great tenacity inside, and also understands how to get position.
Really a nice story with Corey Beck as well, who actually came up a year early, Billy, as you recall, from the junior college ranks, wanting to be with the program for 3 years, paid his own way the year he had to sit out, as we take a look at Shawnelle Scott coming back in for St. John's, trying to find out who he was replacing, I guess.
And Nolan Richardson saying, hey, how about a technical foul here? At least he's going to question and look at the officials a little bit, because Scott walked in without reporting. Both coaches have been very patient with the officials in this game as well, you know?
They really have. They really have.
And we heard so much talk about Vanderbilt's situation, of course, playing there this year, and the coaches talking about having to coach on the end line. It got to Nolan Richardson this year when he played at Vandy. He was thrown out of that game. Some people said it was the longest technical foul call in the history of the game, 94 feet, but it is frustrating for a coach there who's not used to it to have to coach on the end line instead of the sideline.
Dale Brown knows that all too
well. Oh, yeah. Good entry pass. Now, there was the angle Scott can't deliver.
Lamont Middleton did a nice job of keeping that ball alive, tapping it back along with Scott. Derek Brown, David Cain, Lamont Middleton, Fred Lyson, and Shawnelle Scott, the five for St. John's in red.
Pretty nice, solid screen. Cain does a good job realizing he has a big man on him now.
Scott with the rebound, goes up strong and gets it. Shawnelle Scott with his 5th point of the afternoon, averaging 14 on the season.
Now, Scott can play behind Williamson as opposed to when Beckett was trying, Minimum was trying to do it earlier in the game. They're giving up too much size, but Scott's got 2-3 inches on Williamson, so he can get by with it.
Shepard off the mark that time for Arkansas. 0-9 for Shepard.
And when Arkansas doesn't score consistently, they can't get into their trapping defense.
Nice.
Thurman with a good rebound and an outlet. Hawkins, solid player. Had a big game last year in the NCAA tournament. Scored 22 against Memphis State in this same round. Dangerous pass. Here's Hawkins again ahead of the pack.
16:09 left in the ball game, 53-48 St. John's.
Shawnelle Scott trying to get a little bit cute, handling the ball out front. The man that St. John's wants to have it in the hands is right here, David Cain. Notice how they picked up the offense high now, which means that there should be an opportunity to break in behind the defense. There it is.
Boy, Billy Packer, you're all over that.
That was a very subtle move by St. John's, but a great one.
Ryan Mahoney doing a nice job of recognizing where the opportunities are. And Williamson. It looks like the foul was called on Beck, and we'll verify that when we come back.
Imagine a rent-a-car company that offers special delivery right to your door. That's Enterprise.
Here, let me help you.
Enterprise, a special rent-a-car company that gives you special delivery. Gillette introduces the best shaving gel ever. New Gillette Gel. Advanced lubricants. Easier razor glide. An incredibly smooth shave. Now, the best gel is Gillette Gel.
Green had a problem. Nobody knows what to wear with me, he said. I'm tired of not fitting in. Fortunately, Dockers had the solution. From cactus green and olive, evergreen to loden, we made shades of green that went with just about everything. Now Green's got a new problem. Says he's feeling overworked. Should have expected it. Nobody does green like Dockers.
Too many businesses today leave their customers up in the air. But Allstate is different. Your Allstate agent's job is to keep you secure for years to come. To stick by you so that you stay with Allstate for your car insurance and home insurance. For years. For life. You're in good hands with Allstate.
Just because you got 2.3 kids. Just because you got a house, a lawn, and a mortgage. Just because you're now a responsible adult. You still know how to have a good time. Don't you? The new Grand Am Sports Sedan.
Lee Horsley.
I think he sent us.
Investigates crimes of passion.
You let that monster back out onto the street.
His life on the line. Bodies of Evidence returns Friday, April 2nd.
Back to live action, and Billy, you were right. We saw David Libby signal what we thought was a foul. Nice inbound pass and score by Thurman, and actually it was a timeout called by Arkansas, so no foul.
Boy, a beautiful play that time. Scotty Thurman caught ground, napping a little bit. The lob right over the top. As a guard, you don't expect another guard to get a lob pass in an out-of-bounds situation. But Thurman is an explosive leaper. Well-conceived play. Nice job by Scott. We talked about entry angle earlier on in the first half. St. John's not getting it. Now they are. 45 degrees or less.
And you're not talking about temperature.
Nope.
Florida State pulling away convincingly from Tulane.
Well, the ACC with two big blowouts here so far today.
And there was a second, that 45-point victory by Carolina.
Oh, tough break by Hawkins.
Good play by Cain.
He had it and got it stripped. And instead of an Arkansas retrieve, 2 points for St. John's. Tough break for the Razorbacks.
Well, Kane does all the subtle things so well.
Well, he stayed with it. You know, you really had no reason to chase that one down. Looked like Hawkins had it.
So he thought as well. 59-50. St. John's on top. 14-24. Left in the ball game.
Nolan Richardson has got to pick up tempo somehow. He hasn't been able to create it because he's not scoring enough to be able to get into his full court pressure. It's a low scoring game, a relatively low scoring game.
And that's exactly what Mike Francesa was referencing in the studio, looking for one of the surges. But St. John's doing a nice job, except here, Williamson gets a nice pass and spin move.
And why Scott has got to, if you're going to play behind him the whole time. Don't get in a situation where you try to break over the top because Williamson is just too strong and he'll make that quick pivot on you.
And that's the wide body that Bill Raftery was saying he would like to see more of here in the second half, and Williamson doing it.
Middleton wanted to go inside to Shawnelle Scott, who now can play the same game with Williamson.
Middleton up strong with the left hand and is fouled.
We see the play now. Watch how Scott tries to fight over the top. When he does, there's how he got pinned. So if you're going to play behind a guy in the low post, don't try to change up at the last minute because you're going to get burned, and Shawnelle Scott did.
And the other half of what worked well on that execution, the pass. Billy, you talk so often about how the pass tells the offensive player where the defender is.
Exactly. Luke in, looking for the outside shot.
Lyson out. Crawford in for Arkansas. Hawkins to take a seat.
I think that Nolan Richardson might have sensed that Hawkins got hurt his leg a little bit going for that loose ball. And he's also a little upset with him. Hey, when you get a loose ball like that, you got to make sure you get possession. That's a big turnover.
Middleton only is 69% free throw shooter as we take a look at Nolan Richardson still teaching on the sidelines aggressively.
And Nolan, of course, has had that advantage of Barnhill Arena since he took over at Arkansas. LSU played in there this year for the last time that somebody will play in Barnhill, so they'll be moving to a new arena. There's Thurman again
on a nice pass.
Nice cut by Thurman. He moves well without the ball.
really understands the game.
Arkansas hanging right in there, as well as St. John's is playing and executing, only holding to a six-point lead with 13-15 left in the game.
How about the way Cain kept his dribble alive even after he beat somebody, instead of picking it up and getting in trouble?
And then burns him offensively. You would hope also that Maurice Brown is sitting down taking some nice notes from an excellent role model in David Cain.
And also deserves a lot of compliments, a lot of pressure on that young man to come in, as we said, only playing 4 minutes a game. There's a strip by Derrick Brown. He's got a chance to go all the way with it.
The benefit of being able to shoot.
Oh, look at
it. Here comes Arkansas. Nice thought and execution by Williamson, back, but not a score.
He's got a 3-on-1 in the wrong numbers, and wisely gets it out. Boy, St. John's dodged the bullet on that one. Derrick Brown. Scott keeping it alive.
Roger Crawford for Arkansas. Over to McDaniel, back to Crawford. Inside to Williamson. Boy, well, Bill Raftery, I continue to reference back to the conversation at halftime in the studio, was saying the same thing we were saying. We need to see more Williamson, and Arkansas knows it all too well.
Well, Shawnelle Scott, of course, you'll see him just crossing half court and not in position to play defense here. Too late getting to the spot. Middleton creates the foul.
Now, Billy, we've seen Williamson as a high school senior in the McDonald's High School All-American game. We see him now at the collegiate level as a freshman. Now, we know that Arkansas is going to go big when Darnell Robinson comes to school, the 6'11 recruit that they have. Do you think Williamson will be as effective moving out a little bit more?
I think he can. I think he's got a nice soft shot. You know, to come back from a leg injury, a foot injury in his particular case, where you really can't get in good shape, I think the young man's doing an excellent job. He'll be a very gifted forward.
No doubt about that.
There's that entry angle we talked about again.
Good job by Beck to take away the turnaround move by Scott. But a nice shot by Luke.
Luke and Lyson.
Sounds like a long
put. Yep, they both come in there and do the one thing for this team, and that is to create some perimeter shooting.
Williamson having his way on the inside, but can't get the roll.
There's Cain again with a crossover dribble. I tell you, when you beat McDaniel with a crossover dribble, you've done something. Remember that
no
deal with Don Brown? He is so quick with his feet.
And a foul called on Len. McDaniel claims he's changed lug nuts on his tire with the car moving.
You can see, JB, St. John's 58%, Arkansas 36%. We're talking about an Arkansas team that shoots 48% on the year. They have not been able to convert in the paint, and that backcourt scoring for St. John's, Cain leading the way, doing the job. And when you think about Holy Cross having 31 turnovers against Arkansas, I'll tell you how well St. John's playing this second half. They've only turned it over one time so far in the second half. There's Arkansas back to the 2-3 zone. I'm surprised they haven't tried that 1-3-1 zone that they worked so effectively the second part of the first half.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that backcourt scoring. Cain has 15 of those 29 points. As St. John's has tied its biggest lead of the ball game right now, 66-56, 11:06 left in the game. Scott.
And there he came with another rebound and gets it stripped himself. That McDaniel is so quick.
The number's 3-on-2. And McDaniel converts.
And Nolan Richardson looks like he's still searching for a lineup here. A lot of time. Cain says, get out of the way, but I'll tell you what, I don't know how much you want to challenge McDaniel.
Mm-hmm. Clint McDaniel right at his season's average with 7.
Those feet moving, so he's always squared up with a dribbler.
Nice pass. Midland can't hold, and it goes in the opposite direction. Razorbacks ball.
Here you see good passing back and forth. Sets up. Perfect jump shot from the wing. Excellent play.
Arkansas refuses to be shaken, trailing 66-58, 10-15 left in the ballgame.
It shows you the confidence that Nolan Richardson has in his bench. Thurman not in the game now. Williamson not in the game.
Stewart is in the game.
And they're making a comeback without either of those two guys.
Down by just 6
ahead to Midland. A pass to catch. But a smart move on a part of Midland.
Nice. So you've got
David Cain points to himself, Billy, and says, my fault, just as you indicated.
Well, he might have been able to put a little bit more arc on that ball because that was a tough one to run down. But you've got Williamson, Hawkins, Beck sitting down, so maybe he's getting ready to let him have about a two-minute rest here. Great comeback with his squad on the floor.
Lee Green in for St. John's. Shepherd, Crawford, Lynn, Stewart, and McDaniel, the five in white for Arkansas.
And Shepherd has not had much of an offensive day, though he's got the shots.
McDaniel is doing it. Clint McDaniel continuing to play well. He's got nine.
I think it's timeout, St. John's. I think you need to go ahead and slow this down.
Down to four.
Yep.
And Scott blows the dunk, but it's fouled.
Well, you couldn't ask for a better dish. Scott's got to go ahead and complete that. And here's McDaniel flying through. And look at how he used his body not to draw the charge. Scott had to finish that play. St. John's really needed that one.
Scott has seven. Seven below this season's average.
Well, he spent so much time in both the Texas Tech game and this game on the bench in the first half due to foul trouble.
Which says about a lot about the rest of the St. John's team.
And you see who's coming in for him, Foster on the sideline. And I think Brian says, wait a second. Lou Foster just playing better.
Big rebound for St. John's.
To the huge steal.
Billy, now that is what you call nerve-wracking defense.
Well, Kane realized he had a superstar guarding him. And he's doing everything he can to keep it away from him. And there's no question it was a hole. It was a good call. But McDaniel is a guy you just want to say, hey, I'm going to pass to somebody else and take him away from the ball, which is what Kane does right now. Smart play.
Foster in for St. John's, along with Derek Brown. This is Luke for three.
Don't think he had it in his hands, did he?
Lynn out to Crawford.
St. John's, it looked like they were in perfect position to get control of this game. 10-point lead. Now they're battling for their lives.
Crawford. Derek Brown with the rebound. Well, Arkansas's bench has really played a big role in this, contributing 22 points and cutting the St. John's lead to four, and the ball heads in the opposite direction.
Now, does Nolan Richardson stay with his second club, or does he get ready? Now, he put Beck back in there, but he's got Hawkins and Williamson sitting on the bench and Thurman sitting on the bench.
Well, I'm a great armchair coach. I'd stay with this lineup here personally for a minute.
I say he's going to bring him back in at the six-minute mark, make that final push.
I'd agree with that timing. It stays in this direction here. Arkansas ball. In the ball game, the number four seed Arkansas trailing St. John's, the number five seed, by four. 22 points contributed by Arkansas's bench has cut into a 10-point St. John's lead. Stewart,
good rebound by Foster.
And Foster has been doing the job on the boards.
Right, he has actually outplayed Scott. It's not foul trouble or anything else. He's just outperformed him.
He's got nine boards on the afternoon. He being Mitchell Foster. It's Cain, Derrick Brown, Sergio Luke, Mitchell Foster, and Charles Midland, the five in red for St. John's.
Nice backdoor cut.
Crawford.
And Cain's got to let him go. He's got to. You know what? I sense Cain's a little tired. I really do.
And he's bending over, grabbing his shorts.
I think he's tired, which is what Nolan Richardson wanted to create.
And what the Razorbacks have created is an 8-0 run to trail by only two. St. John's has played so well, limiting Arkansas's effectiveness defensively, and no surges.
And you see what Nolan Richardson's doing is a wise thing. He knows Kane's tired, too. He put Beck on him now, so he keeps putting different fresh men on him. Kane is exhausted at the top of the... He's out of the half court. having a hard time breathing right now.
A hard time also being had by Stewart, who picks up his fourth personal foul as Corliss Williamson comes back in replacing Stewart. Lynn takes a seat as Scotty Thurman, the man you said, will be back in at about the six-minute mark, 6:56. 6:57, that is, left in the ballgame.
Yep, and they come back in fresh. Just two down. Great job by the bench. You can see that 8-0 run, and it was created with three key starters sitting on the bench. St. John's wanting to save their timeouts, but I think they're going to have to use them here sporadically to just to go ahead and let Cain rest.
So, Cain, I was about to ask, do you bring Maurice Brown back in?
I don't think you can.
You don't?
No, okay. Not with 6 minutes to go. I think you got to keep him on the floor and use some timeouts. And you see what happened here? Nice conversation. And then when you coach and player and said, hey, are you tired? And he said, feel free to call a timeout.
And then you hope that Cain is being honest so that he doesn't get careless in the situation with Arkansas trailing by just three.
Now that shows you what McDaniel has done and how quick he is. Nice solid screen by Foster.
Well, I guess Cain isn't too tired, huh, Billy?
What a play.
David Cain with 17 points on the afternoon. He averages 11.
You know, he's great at that little 12-foot jump shot that he's got after he penetrates. Elevates off the floor.
Beck, who likes it in tight territory, passes to Williamson.
Well, what happened? Foster was trying to go over and help Brown, who he felt needed some help against the stronger Beck, but when he went for the double team, Beck saw the open man.
A three-point ball game under 6 minutes to play in the contest. North Carolina has already advanced to the Sweet 16. Arkansas and St. John's battling for the next spot.
That was McDaniel again with that quickness. It's Beck on Cain. Cain really feeling the pressure now.
McDaniel. That is pressure. A three that ties the ball game. 5:35 left in the contest.
Now St. John's looks like they're now just trying to get the ball over half court. They're no longer attacking against Arkansas. That could hurt them. It was a key timeout.
A very important timeout to rest David Cain as Arkansas has tied it.
The NCAA Women's Final Four, April 3rd on CBS.
If this is how you think of Volvos, we may have the car to change your thinking. The Volvo 850 GLT.
Now McDonald's always has one extra value meal for $2.99. Might be this one, this one, this one, or... To find out which extra value meal is $2.99, go to your local McDonald's. Because if you want to know, you gotta go. Come on, no food fights. You know McDonald's extra value meals come with golden fries and icy Coca-Cola, right? Good. You know there's now always one on the menu for $2.99. Okay, and you know which extra value meal is $2.99 at your McDonald's.
On CBS.
5:24 left in the game. Tie ball game, 69 apiece. You take a look at the vitals there. Both teams with two timeouts. And the possession arrow favors St. John's. Neither team in trouble in terms of the bonus with fouls. Billy, let's talk strategy here.
Well, now it's McDaniel back on Cain. Hawkins can chase you well, too. Cain's got nothing going for himself there. Really got a break. Shot clock down to 18.
Derrick Brown has it blocked from behind, but gets it up there anyway. And Hawkins with the rebound. The quick jumping ability of Arkansas paying dividends down the stretch.
Yep. Brown figured it as a man coming in behind him. Nice pump fake by Hawkins.
And Hawkins helps Arkansas on a 15-3 run the last 6.5 minutes.
Do you notice that St. John's has not gotten an easy basket in a long time? They've had to work for everything. And the other thing, Arkansas has not been following them.
Foster.
Big momentum shift.
And Foster is whistled for the foul. Mitchell Foster picking up his third.
Oh, it's going to be Shawnelle Scott coming back in. There was a little conversation between player and coach involving Scott during that last timeout. And now it's going to be up to the second team All Big East man to show that he belongs as a leader on this team. He has not gotten it done today. Foster picked it up for him.
14 fouls on St. John's, 5 on Arkansas. The Redmen have turned the ball over 6 times during this run by the Razorbacks.
You know, I got to thank Williamson here. Make Scott work against him. They've been doing it everything with the perimeter. So St. John's is having to pull out. Let's see if Williamson, he doesn't get the touch.
The numbers for St. John's off of his way. And Cain is fouled by Scotty Thurman.
Good hustle by David Cain.
And Billy, I mentioned the word fatigue at the top of the game, wondering whether or not down the stretch it would affect Cain. Cain clearly is laboring right now.
Oh, yeah, without question. And, of course, we saw him hit the wall here a couple of minutes ago, and I think what caused it is that the Corey Becks and McDaniels all day long have been chasing him.
That can do it.
And it finally got to him, yep. But he's hanging in there, a gutty performer.
That he is.
We talked about him the other day. 3 years, he went 9/10 of a point, 2.6 points a game, and then 2.5 points a game, and now all Big East first teamer, and deservedly so.
Mm-hmm. And 19 points today. Tie ball game, 71 apiece, under 4 to play.
And if you think in overtime has not been good to either one of these clubs. St. John's has lost 2 of them this year, Seton Hall in Connecticut.
Mm-hmm. And Oakland to Connecticut,
yep,
and 10 points to Seton Hall.
Right. And Ole Miss got Arkansas.
Which Arkansas considers the low point of the season for them.
Now with McDaniel moving, Kane's got to work hard on defense.
Stolen by Scott. Is the foul whistled against Scott?
Wow,
it looks like it is, and that will be number 3.
Pretty good defensive play, but he did use his inside arm.
Well, what do you think?
I think I feel safe in that car.
What about the money?
What about the lease?
Yeah, it's a good lease. Can you really see us in a Mercedes?
Definitely.
The Win-Win Lease is available on selected Mercedes-Benz models. Visit your authorized Mercedes dealer for details.
Sure, football is tough, but the toughest game of all is that of life. That's why the NCAA Foundation, along with the help of Anheuser-Busch, have offered grants through their Choices program. These grants are used to fund campus-wide alcohol educational programs to discourage underage drinking and encourage responsible decision-making in all aspects of the student's life. Working together, we can make a difference.
The third cluster of games coming to you today in a cluster of 4 will be Illinois against Vanderbilt, BYU against Kansas, Western Kentucky against Seton Hall. Seton Hall having won 12 straight games, including the Big East title.
Well, you talk about the Rodney Dangerfield. How about Western Kentucky? Hey, they went in and played Louisville at Louisville this year and won, so I don't think we should write them off yet.
Not at all. Ralph Willard, a Rick Pitino disciple, coaching that squad and having done a magnificent job. 71 all here. 3:18 left in the ball game.
Scotty Thurman moving without the ball. He's got Beckett on him, trying to find something freeing up by running the baseline and picking him off inside.
There have been 3 ties in this ball game. Arkansas's defense still hanging in to keep them in.
Out of a box set. Here's Thurman. He's got it.
Thurman.
Boy, he is so patient.
A broken play that comes up effective for Arkansas, and the Razorbacks have a 2-point lead with 2:45 left.
How about getting the ball down low to Shawnelle Scott?
Williamson defending him down low.
They can't get the lob.
Middleton can't get the drop.
Brown had to stick his nose in there. Hawkins just beat him to the spot. Just better superior hustle by Hawkins.
And better team quickness.
Yep. He had 8 steals yesterday to set a new record. And he just got to the spot on that one.
On in the ball board. 8 of 10 from the floor, and Cain can't answer. Scott keeps it alive. Derrick Brown off the back of the iron. Rebound.
Hawkins again.
By Hawkins.
There's no question that Nolan Richardson, by putting Hawkins, Beck, and Thurman on the bench for that rest of about 4 or 5 minutes where he got great production off the bench and able his team to be much fresher.
And a timeout called by Arkansas as the Razorbacks enjoy their biggest lead of the game. Razorbacks with one timeout left, St. John's with two.
Full second.
Arkansas leads at 75-71, 1:48 left in the ball game. Arkansas with one timeout remaining, St. John's with two. Billy, strategy here.
Well, you can see that Nolan Richardson decided to go back and pull the ball back out, make St. John's chase him a little bit. Here they are, just trying to occupy some time. A little early maybe to pull the strategy,
good
ball, but nice
move
hit
to McDaniel.
Red St. John's out. I'm kind of surprised that St. John's went into a panic chase.
They were up by six, Billy.
They were just down four. No reason to get spread out that badly.
There's a Cain to Brown. Rebounded by Thurman. Ahead to Beck and to Williamson.
Oh, and a push.
Intentional foul.
Well, they don't call it intentional. I think they should have. Without question, it should have been an intentional. Not going for the ball. Watch Scott push him from behind. That's an intentional foul. Should be two and the ball.
Now, Luke coming in for St. John's.
And you know why? He's going to put up the three-point shot.
In for Beckett.
But I thought it with a minute and 40 seconds to go, a little early to go start chasing somebody when you're just down 4 points. Gave an easy basket to McDaniel.
Williamson makes the first,
hot from the line. Well, we should have known that Arkansas is ready to come back because they were down 17-0 to Kentucky in the SEC tournament. Came back to the point where they got it to 55-53. So this club is young and very spirited.
Misses the second. 78-71, 1:07 left.
Plenty of time. He's got to think three, though. Look for Luke. Set a screen and then step out. Here he goes looking for the switch.
And Cain. No basket and a charge.
Big play. Huge call. Weak side help against Cain. That's Kane's fourth. He did beat the defense that time. Here comes Cain. Defense waiting on him.
Four fouls, seven turnovers for David Cain, and that's what I'm pointing to about maybe the fatigue slightly down the stretch for David Cain. 78-71.
Got a foul now. Got a foul now. Got a foul. Got a foul and shoot threes.
Too late.
Still no foul. Too late. Too late. Now they'll foul, and they've wasted 25 seconds on the clock.
Boy, 15 on the shot clock, 28 in the game clock.
Ball game.
Four. Give the credit to Arkansas.
The SEC advances another club. Oh, there's a bad mistake by Beck.
Fouling Derrick Brown, who will take a trip with 17.9 seconds remaining and a 9-point Arkansas lead.
Boy, you're up nine. You let the guy take the three, JB. The clock would have kept moving. Arkansas celebrating, but not a smart play there.
Still to come, Illinois, Vanderbilt, BYU, Kansas, Western Kentucky, and Seton Hall. Illinois with Deion Thomas, Vanderbilt, Billy McCaffrey headlining that contest there.
Now, another thing you could think about right here, and I realize this is a reach, make two and try to miss that third one. All of the Tennessee-Kentucky game, even though that was an illegal play, because you need the ball back. Now he should try to miss this shot. I would have put Shawnelle, Scott, and maybe Foster on the line and go for the rebound. You want to miss this because you need a possession again. He makes it. That 1 point's not as good as the possession. And it looks like St. John's just going to let him play this thing out. Sure do.
Trailing by only six or two.
I don't understand that. I don't understand that at all.
Ah.
No.
Billy, I hear you.
No, sir. I think
you're right.
There was a lot of strategy that could have been used for the last 20 seconds of that game, and none of it tried. And it might have been a reach, but you got to try everything when you're in an NCAA tournament.
I absolutely agree. Arkansas used a 24-8 run to end the game and come out on top 80-74 over St. John's. So the number four seed, Arkansas, will advance to the round of 16, as did North Carolina earlier by virtue of a 45-point victory over Rhode Island. So from the Winston-Salem site, it's North Carolina advancing and Arkansas pulling out a second half victory over St. John's. And the Chevy players of the game, David Cain of St. John's and Scotty Thurman of Arkansas. Right now, let's take you back to New York. The triumvirate there, Francesa, Raftery, and Jim Nance.
All right, James Brown. So the late surge by Arkansas sends them to the Sweet 16. Next will be North Carolina on Friday at the Meadowlands. Now, BYU and Kansas has just started. That's a 5-5 game.